Welcome to the online service. My name is Reverend John Barker of the Northern Beaches Uniting Church, and I'll be delivering the message today. Reverend Marta, I understand, is on leave, so good morning to all those at Northern Beaches who are listening in this morning. Mark chapter 9, verses 38 to 50. Whoever is not against us is for us. Teacher, said John, we saw someone driving out demons in your name, and we told him to stop because he was not one of us. Do not stop him, Jesus said, for no one who does a miracle in my name can in the next moment say anything bad about me. For whoever is not against us is for us. Truly, I tell you, anyone who gives you a cup of water in my name because you belong to the Messiah will certainly not lose their reward. Poor old disciples. They are constantly trying to understand what it means to be disciples, what it means to participate with each other in the ministry of Jesus. Teacher, said John, we saw someone doing something they shouldn't be doing. What was it? Well, none other than driving out demons. What's so wrong about that, we might ask? Well, it turns out driving out demons is perfectly okay back then. They called it exorcism. Language of driving out demons back in Jesus' day was a good thing. Maybe it's still a good thing, depending on your theology. But the issue that got the disciples in a twist was not the actual act of driving out demons. It was who was doing it. Who was undertaking this ministry in the name of Jesus? The exorcists were performing their ministry in the name of Jesus, and, says John, he was not one of us. So the big question in today's gospel is, when is someone not one of us? The disciples, with all good intention, I'm sure, essentially drew a circle around Jesus to keep their emerging faith intact. This circle, in this case, kept the exorcist out. I mean, maybe he should have been kept out, I don't know. But in many other gospel stories, the circle reappears. Just to quote a few that I'm sure we're familiar with, the Samaritan woman. She was hated and rejected as an outcast of the worst type, especially by the Jews. She is not one of us, the Jews would have agreed. Yet Jesus, in the Gospels, as a teaching opportunity, took his followers, all whom were Jewish, and made a point to actually walk through Samaria. And Jesus stopped and rested at one of the Samaritan wells, and he struck up a conversation with a woman, a sinner and an outcast. This Samaritan woman. And after he witnessed to her, he headed into town with the woman and hung out with the villagers for 2 additional days. Probably not any of them would have been in the category of one of us. And Matthew, a tax collector. Tax collectors were known amongst the community as notorious thieves and swindlers. Certainly not one of us. This didn't stop Jesus from reaching out to Matthew, from eating dinner with him and other disreputable individuals of the society. And just to drive the point home, he did the same in another town with a different tax collector named Zacchaeus. And all the healings of Jesus, all redemptive acts, no doubt the rhetoric would have been the same. Not one of us. 10 men with leprosy. Certainly not one of us. They even had to stand at a distance when they called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." The man born blind, considered cursed. And the people would spit on him as they walked past him. "Not one of us," they would have said. To curse the curse, Jesus spat on the ground and made some mud with his saliva and put it in the man's eyes and healed him. Jesus' choice of company, his openness to all, did indeed upset most of the religious leaders. This is a topic that's picked up by a very famous theologian who lived in the mid-1900s, Dietrich Bonhoeffer. I love reading his theology, and every now and again it reignites my interest. I was reading a book recently called Bonhoeffer, A Theology of Sociality by Clifford Green. I'll put it up on the screen. And it spoke to me of how Bonhoeffer came up with a classic phrase called non-religious Christianity. When you first say that, it sort of sounds a bit antichrist, doesn't it? But he was using this phrase in a provocative way to get people thinking around what Jesus was stressing in our reading today as to who is one of us. What it means, really, to be Christian. Jesus did not operate within the parameters dictated by his culture. Society sees people according to, well, stuff, you know, stereotypes. But Jesus, however, was rubbing out the boundaries. I think he would have liked whiteboards and blackboards, you know, rubbing out the boundaries. He opened up everyone to the personal message of Christ, which was redemption. Now, where might this end? Well, to all the world, it seems. But we are all human. We like our boundaries, but the gospel message of Jesus Christ is always going beyond our boundaries. The non-religion Christianity for Bonhoeffer is to ask, how can Christ become Lord also of the religionless? Some might say it's impossible. Some might say we can't answer that yet. But at the very least, it does make us think about how the Christian message might engage non-religious people. I was so very proud of our church the last couple of weeks. We stepped out of our own comfort zone and we had to take the emphasis off what we normally do at Manly, and we partnered with the Manly Club. We fed dozens of people in need from the Manly Church. And I must say, in Bonhoeffer's language, it didn't feel very well religious, but it did feel redemptive. We had one volunteer working with us, a young man who was certainly not part of our religious community. And I thought about our scripture verses while I was working that day. And I thought, well, our volunteer is certainly not in the category of one of us. But in our ministry outreach, he felt so one with us. He is not one of us, John said. He told the person to stop what he was doing. And what was Jesus' response? "Don't stop him," he yelled. "For whoever is not against us is for us." Jesus just expands the tent pegs. He steps out of defined boundaries and takes his disciples with him. Do not stop him or her. Maybe even join with him or her. Hopefully, as we approach a new season ahead of us, getting out of our lockdown, isn't that exciting? It might be a good time to think about where Jesus might be taking us in the season ahead. Where is Jesus taking you in your ministry, in the ministry with the church? Where is he taking you? What boundaries is Jesus asking us to cross in the days and weeks ahead. Send me a message, let me know, and I hope you can join us next week. And until then, keep crossing some boundaries, keep safe, and God bless.
The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness strives to hide. Trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? All will see how great, how great is our God.
Great is our God. All will see.